Okay, so it is my pleasure to introduce our first speaker. It's Welington de Oliveira from the State University of Rio de Janeiro, UERJ. And he will talk about scenario tree reduction via quadratic process distances applied to hydrothermal scheduling problems.
Thank you, Claudia. Good morning. Thank you all for being here. In this talk, I'm going to present an application of scenario tree reduction in multi-stage stochastic program. The problem of interest is the Brazilian hydrothermal scheduling problem, which is modeled as a multi-stage stochastic linear program, whose the goal is to determine power generation to meet at the minimum expected cost a lower demand. The main source of uncertainty in this problem is the amount of water arriving into the hydro plant's reservoirs. The future water inflow is modeled as a stochastic process that is represented by a multi-stage scenario tree. The larger is the scenario tree, the better is representation of the uncertainties. However, large scenario trees lead to a prohibitive computational effort to solve the underlying stochastic problem. In order to find an equilibrium between numerical tractability and the representation of the uncertainties, we are going to apply a scenario reduction algorithm recently proposed by Kovacevic and Pichler to obtain a smaller but very representative scenario tree. This algorithm is based on the nested distance proposed by Professor George Pfluke to measure the distance between two stochastic processes. This is a joint work with Erlon Finard and our PhD student, Felipe Rodrigues. And this research was the final work of Felipe's master at the Federal University of Santa Catarina. Well, let me start with some characteristics of the Brazilian hydrothermal scheduling problem. Well, it is predominantly hydraulic. Around 62% of the total power generation is due to hydro plants. The complement of the power generation is due to thermal plants, 30%, and 8% of alternative source, like eolic power generation. As I said, the main source of uncertainty is the amount of water arriving into the hydro plant's reservoirs. These uncertainties are modeled as a stochastic process following a log normal distribution. But the source, the uncertainties are not the only difficulty in this problem. The problem is difficult itself because of its dimension. For just to give you an idea, this is a Brazilian map and an interconnected power system. For example, a power plant in the south can generate and send electricity up to the north of the country or northwest, and this distance is around 4,000 kilometers. If you get the Brazilian map and put over the European map, the resulting power system would be the one starting from Portugal up to Russia. So it's a really huge power system. And because of that, the planning problem is split into steps and phases. For example, we have the medium-term planning problem, which is 5 years planning horizon with monthly steps. We make decisions monthly. And another one, the short-term, 2 months. And decisions are made the first month is split in the weekly. Weekly is we make the decisions at every week. And the second month, you consider the whole month. Here, in this medium term, the uncertainties are represented by a multi-stage scenario tree, the water inflows. Once this problem is solved, the output of the model is useful to set the problem, the short-term problem. We use some results, some outputs here to optimize, to solve the problem, the short-term problem. And when you solve this short-term problem, we have the spot price of electricity. The goal is to minimize the expected cost, the power generation, subject to some physical constraints. In fact, here is missing the uncertainty in this feasible set. The uncertainty comes there too. To give you an idea how the decision of today impacts the decision of tomorrow, let's consider a stage of time, T, and we have to make a decision of power generation. We can, just to simplify, let's have alternative to make two decisions only. One decision is to generate power using thermal plants. In this case, we keep water in the reservoirs. And another decision, we generate power, electricity using water. I mean, by power hydro plants. So when you use hydro plants, the cost of generation is cheap because the water is for free. And the other decision here, using power plants, is expensive. So if you take a look in the next stage of decision, stage T plus one, if the amount of water, the water inflows arriving to the reservoirs is high, and we kept water in the reservoirs in the stage T, so we are going to spillage water. So the reservoirs are full, more water is coming, we don't have space for that water, we throw that water away. So this is not a good strategy, a good decision. In this case, keep water in the reservoirs, but we don't know the future. On the other hand, if the amount of water is low, so that decision of keeping water in the reservoirs was an acceptable decision. And you can make the same analysis for the other case in which we use the available water at stage T to generate power, to generate electricity. In this case, if you use the water in the reservoir at stage T and we expect a low water inflow for the next stage, we can have a blackout. We cannot have water enough to generate electricity to combine with thermal generation to meet the demand. So of course, this is the most expensive decision. So to summarize, what we want to make is a decision that takes into account the cost of generation today and the future cost of generation. We want to find an optimal decision that is a decision that's optimal on average. The problem that we are going to focus in this talk is the short term. So the current approach for this problem is the following. It is modeled as a two-stage stochastic linear program problem because the first month, we don't consider scenarios for the water inflows in the first month. We consider forecast, so just one value for each week here. And the second month, then we consider some scenarios. Although this problem is not solved as a two-stage stochastic linear program problem because it's a Bender decomposition, but it could be solved by L-shaped method, for example. The difficulty here is the fact that it's difficult to forecast water inflows along the weeks. So this problem is solved like that. The first week, generate a trill like that and solve the problem. The second week, when this value is revealed, we update this value, we generate a new forecast here for the other weeks, and a new tree. The fact is, if you make a poor forecast here, the tree, scenario tree for the second week can be very different from this. And this increases the volatility of spot prices. We want to reduce this volatility. And the strategy is then to consider scenarios also for the weeks. So here you construct a scenario tree. And for each node, for the second month, you have also some openings in this tree. So in this case, we are in the multi-stage program setting. we have a better representation of the uncertainties because we are considering a bigger tree. We can improve the decisions. We can decrease the volatility of the spot price. However, we increase the computational effort to solve the stochastic problem. And the aim is to find an equilibrium between numerical tractability and the representation of the uncertainties. For doing that, what we are going to do is to work with scenario reduction techniques. The aim is to consider a larger tree of scenarios representing the uncertainties of water inflow. And given this large tree, we are going to apply an algorithm to reduce this tree into a smaller but representative tree, aiming at obtaining adherence in the optimum value decisions we would have made with the larger tree. To reduce scenario tree, there are many alternatives. We can, for example, use clustering techniques, for example, algorithm k-means. In the two stage, we have some methods proposed. It gives those methods provide stability results for stochastic two-stage stochastic programs. And the last years, a great development has been done for the multi-stage setting. We now have results also based on probabilistic metrics, providing stability results for multi-stage case. And in this talk, we apply the tools developed in those papers. This one by Professor Pflug and Pichler, Kovacevic and Pichler. Those are the tools we are going to apply for our practical problem. The problem statement is the following. T is the planning horizon. We represent the stochastic process by xi. And this is a filtration sequence of sigma algebras. If you are thinking of scenarios three, this filtration represents the structure of this scenario three. The problem of interest is a minimization of expected cost. Our function is linear, feasible set is polyhedral, and uncertain, as I said previously, the uncertainty is also here in this set. And well, that's the problem we are going to solve depending on a given scenario three. So let's take two filtered probability space. We can think about this filtered space like this is a large scenario tree and this is a reduced scenario tree. Yes? The prime here is just to say that it's different than the other one. Subject to, here. Non-anticipative constraints. Ah, yeah. Yeah, non-subjective constraints. Thank you.
It seems like a tree.
Yeah, I'm using the notation of Professor George Flood. So what I'm going to tell? Yes. Sorry. Okay. So we can think in this probability space as scenario trees. This is the original one, a large tree, and this is a smaller one. And given a scenario tree, you solve the problem, you have an optimal value and a policy, and you can also define another problem with the reduced tree. And it was shown in this paper that the optimal value of this two stochastic process, the optimal value resulting of the problem of that stochastic process, is Hölder continuous with respect to this measure, and this D is the nested distance that computes the distance between two stochastic processes. So we have here the filtered stochastic process. This small d is a distance function. You can think of this function as a Euclidean norm, for example, measuring the distance between two scenarios. And so this expression defines the nested distance. The minimum here is over the bivariate probability measures on this space here of sigma algebras. The constraints are taking into account the structure of this stochastic process. If you are thinking of scenario trees, like in this case, those constraints can be understood as conditional probabilities at every node of the tree. But this is the nested distance, and in this work we are going to deal with quadratic process distance. What's the difference? The quadratic process distance is a particular case of nested distance where we take, for example, D as the Euclidean norm. In this case, we take here a matrix M, definite positive, that's going to be useful for our application. But just to summarize, quadratic process distance is a particular case of nested distance. This is, and another measure that is important in scenario reduction techniques is the Wasserstein distance. This is suitable for two-stage stochastic program. And if you see here, the difference in this distance, we don't take into account the structure of the stochastic process. You are paying attention only at the last stage, while here we are taking into account also intermediate states. So it turns out that for if t is equal to 2 stage, then the nested distance boils down to be the Wasserstein distance, Wasserstein distance. And this inequality always holds because, of course, this problem here has more constraints. Well, and how it is in the discrete stochastic process, scenario trees? The nested distance can be written in this form, where those p's are the probability of nodes. So p, probability of nodes of the large tree, p prime, probability of nodes of the smaller tree. And we have here some notation. This n aleph t is the set of nodes of each stage. The set of children nodes of a given node is n plus. The predecessor of a node is n minus. And this notation we use to say that this node m is in the path of scenario I. Because those probabilities are known, this problem is a linear program problem. That's nice, that's very nice. However, depending on the size of the trees, this LEP can be really large. And it was shown in this paper that this LEP can be solved, can be decomposed into pairs of nodes of the trees into smaller LEPs. So the quadratic process distance can be computed, solving directly this LEP, or alternatively, splitting this problem into smaller subproblems. We have a recursion equation here. And it was shown that solving the sequence of LEPs, we can indeed solve the large LEP. But here, so far, I have said about how to compute the distance between two trees, but not about how to reduce a tree. And for doing that, we rely on the algorithm proposed by Kovacevic and Pichler. And the algorithm works as follows. We have an original tree, a large tree, I call original tree here. There is the first phase, which is we provide an initial point for the algorithm. It means we are going to give a smaller tree with a certain structure that we wish. I want the tree, a smaller tree, with a certain structure, and I give this structure here. And then the algorithm moves to the second phase, in which there is a loop updating the probability of these trees and updating the value of the nodes of the trees in order to decrease the nested distance. And at the end, we are going to get a smaller scenario tree that minimizes the nested distance between all the all the trees this size of this structure. But in fact, the algorithm is it's not ensured to provide the best tree. But as we are going to see next, the results, these three provided by the algorithm, is really good. It provides very good results. I want to focus now in this phase two, how it works. Well, there is two steps in that phase. One is, given approximating tree, we find the probabilities that decrease the nested distance. And this is done by solving a sequence of LPs. Once you have this updated probability, we move to the second step, which consists in updating the nodes of the trees, assigning new values for the nodes of the trees. So for the first step, we are going to solve a linear program problem, a sequence of those. And this is more or less similar to the one I presented previously. However, the probability of the reduced tree is unknown. So it's set here as a variable. And the decomposition cannot be done nodes by nodes by gathering a sequence of nodes. For example, we have this original tree and the reduced one. We want to update those probabilities here. And we focus on all the nodes here, and this small tree, and then to this one, and then we move backwards, and we compute to update all the probabilities of these trees. The second step consists in giving the probability, improving the nested distance, but the problem we are going to deal with is to minimize this objective value, which is the expected value with respect to this bivariate probability distribution and the distance between the scenarios. The scenarios of the original tree and the new scenarios. This is the decision variable in this case. And for the particular case of this distance, this form, the solution of this problem is given by explicit form. So we don't need to make any iterative process. However, if you consider another distance here, for example, L1 norm, so we don't have this expression, and in this case, we must apply an algorithm, optimization algorithm to solve this problem. So this is why we are focused on the quadratic case, because this step is easier. Kovacevic and Pichler, they used the Euclidean norm to define this distance d. So Euclidean norm means the identity matrix here. That was what they used. And Philippe have tried other matrices to define this distance, but using, of course, a matrix that are definite positive. One example is the inverse of a correlation matrix, and this gives the Mahalanob distance that's useful to preserve correlation between, in our case, power plants. Another alternative was to consider M as the power capacity of hydropower plants, in the sense that the larger power plants will have more weight in order to select the scenarios. We are going to focus more on the more important hydro plants when you choose the matrix in this case. So far I talked about how to compute the distance between two trees, original and reduced one, how to apply the algorithm, how works the algorithm by Kovacevic and Pichler. And now I'm going to discuss how we generate the scenario tree. Well, the scenario tree is generated considering a stage-wise independent model. Water inflow in each hydro plant follows a three-parameter log normal distribution. And the water inflows are correlated, meaning that each node of this tree is not one value itself. It's in fact a vector corresponding to values for different hydro plants. And here, to preserve the correlation between the inflows in each node, that this matrix here to define the distance is important. The fact that we are using this stage-wise independent model gives us this representation of the tree. Because, for example, here, this node, the black node has as children a black and a gray node. The gray node has as children black and gray node. White node has as children black and gray. So you can represent this tree in this way. And this assumption simplifies the scenario tree reduction algorithm. Because, as I told you before, we compare nodes of the trees. And with this formulation, the number of nodes we are going to visit is reduced. So the algorithm is very efficient in this case. The algorithm is efficient even more in this case. And how do you test, how do you validate the results of this algorithm? So you consider a large tree, but not so that large that we can solve the problem. And we apply the scenario tree reduction, obtain a reduced tree, another problem. We solve, and you get a polis. So you have two polis, one using the larger tree, and another polis using the smaller tree. And both problems are solved by using the nested decomposition, or also called the nested ladder-shaped method. How it works, I'm not going to explain how this decomposition works, but I'm just giving an idea how we test our results. So the nested decomposition, to apply it, we need to write this problem as these dynamic equations. So for example, here I'm minimizing the first stage cost, subject the future cost. This future cost is defined in this recursive manner. So those functions known to be polyhedral, convex polyhedral, and so on in this linear case. When you solve this problem by using nested decomposition, we use cut-plane model approximations. So instead of iteratively, we're going to construct approximations for this, those functions. And once we solve the larger problem with nested decomposition, we have a policy and I have a cut-plane approximation, approximating the function. We then solve the smaller problem, get this policy, and make a forward pass using those cut-plane approximation for the original problem. And so what I'm saying is the following. So the functions, more or less like this in stage T. Convex in upper parts. This is the function Q. And this T plus 1. When we make a forward pass, we find approximation, for example, here. Approximations of those functions. I call this Q check. And also here. And this for the original problem, the large tree. And when we solve the smaller problem here, we use that polis, another color, she's XP prime, in those models. And we make a forward pass, we end up with an upper bound for the optimum value of this problem. And in this way, we can compute this gap. This is a non-negative. We have another form to validate our results. Well, let me explain here. We have, once again, original tree, apply the nested distance algorithm, the scenario tree algorithm, we obtain the reduced tree. We solve those, the two problems, both problems, using the nested decomposition. we have here, when you solve the original tree, we have the policy and the cutiplane model. Here also, the same thing. But we get this policy combined with that cutiplane model, we define this gap. And then, with both policies here, we make a simulation out of sampling simulation. We consider 2,000, 10,000 scenarios. We make a pass with those, the two both policies, and we get many generation costs. We have a simulation, for example, T0, T. You are going to make many simulations here. We are going to apply the policy XP for the original tree, XP line. When we arrive here, we are going to have many costs. And for one cost for each scenario, we can therefore compute a probability, empirical probability distribution of those costs. This is what we do here. And we can construct this implicit probability distribution using the costs obtained by the two different policies here. And we would like the distribution probability of these two policies to come, the empirical probability distribution, to come from the same probability distribution. This will say that the two policies are statistically the same. Not the same, but statistically the same. And to test that, we use the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test that measures the distance between the two empirical probability distribution here. Our numerical experiments, for our numerical experiments, we consider 20 power plants, being 5 of them thermal plants and 15 hydro plants. Some of those have reservoirs, others no. This is the load demand for the month. The hydro plants are in a cascade. And they use correlation to generate the scenarios and so on. We have here the first table of numerical results. Let me explain here. We have the original three. This is 5 states, 625 scenarios for these three. We solved using the nested decomposition. This is the expected cost. And the total time to solve this problem was around 100 minutes. And we apply the scenario reduction algorithm to this tree, obtain a smaller tree only with 250 scenarios. So the reduction was here in the second stage. It was 5 children of that node, 5 openings, here only 2. And when, in fact, we generated, we obtained 3 different reduced trees. One used the identity matrix in this distance. M here is the identity. Another one is the plant capacity. And another one is inverse of a correlation. We solved the problem for these three different trees. Here's the obtained optimal value. Here's the gap, as I showed you how to compute that gap before. This is in percentage, so you obtain almost the same optimal value. Here is the value of the test, the Kolmogorov-Smirnov test. So if this value is lower than this one, this given by the test, we are considering here 2,000 scenarios for this simulation here, 2,000 scenarios. And it's in blue because all of the tests were approved. All of them were approved, meaning that the optimum value and the policies are statistically the same. And for computing, for reducing and solving the problem for these three, the total time was a little bit more than 13 minutes. So to 100 minutes, now only 13. And we got more or less the same results. Another test with another three different trees with 40 scenarios here the reduction was more effective. In this case, see, the optimum values are a bit different. However, the gap is still less than 1%. The Komarov test passed for all of those results. And in this case, reduction and solution of the problem was around 2 minutes. Another tree with the same number of scenarios, however, with the different structure. See, here we kept the same number of openings at the last stage. The other tree, RT3, it's different because we kept the number of openings in the second stage. And in this case, the optimum value are more different. And see, the result, the gap is more than 1%. However, the Komogorov test also, the results passed in the Komogorov-Smirnov test. But the results here, the gap was a bit bigger. And more or less the same CPU time for, because this size is the same. This suggests us to keep more openings at the end of the planning horizon. Another table of results is the following. Here we have a different original tree. For a stage, 1,000 scenarios, we took 400 minutes to solve this problem. Obtained this scenario, reduced the tree with 120 scenarios, also with the three different distance functions. And we can see here that using this plant capacity matrix to define the distance function, we obtain a better adherence here in the optimum value, since the gap is better than the other two. The Komarov-Smirnov test passed with 2,000 scenarios. And instead of almost 400 minutes, we now could reduce and solve the problem in less than 80 minutes. The same number of scenarios, but with a different structure. Again, opening more at the beginning of the stage and reducing more at the final beginning of the horizon, and here reducing more at the end of the planning horizon. And the results here were not good. For example, here's the gap, 16% of error. Komogorov-Smirnov didn't says that the polys obtained by those trees are not statistically the same than the polys of the larger tree. No, the original is this one with 1,000. Okay. And then we transverse this kind of scenarios here, but using 2,000. So out of sample, another sample.
Can you do out of sampling if you don't assume state-wise independence?
Yes, we can do. It's independently of this assumption. Yeah, but the fact is I get the policy of the first node and I make a forward pass. The first stage policy, the first stage decision, and make a forward pass.
Your value function is defined in terms of the node of the scenario.
Yeah.
Out of sample means you're moving to the new, to the original 1,000 node scenario.
I'm moving to this 2,000 scenario, the new set. Okay.
Because I think when you speak of policy, you are talking about the reconstruction. Right?
Perhaps this is my mistake. When I'm saying policy, you should say policy for all the decisions you make along the planning horizon. And what I'm doing here, in fact, is I get the first decision, the first stage decision, and apply to other set of scenarios, but considering the cutting plane approximation of these three.
Evaluation.
Costigo function. Thank you, Claudia. We can discuss this later. The last table of results is this one, where we consider a larger tree. We have here 7 stages. The total time to solve this tree was more than 1,000 minutes. Using nested decomposition. We reduced the tree to these 1024 scenarios with three different approaches, distance functions. Well, we obtain more or less the same optimum value. This is, those are the gaps. The decisions passed the Komogorov Smirnov test say that the policy, the first stage solution are statistically the same, but here we are using 10,000 scenarios. Well, instead of more than 1,000 minutes, we are now solving, for example, this case here, less than 200 minutes. We can reduce more, for example, for 512 scenarios. And in this case, using this plant capacity to define the distance function, we obtain essentially the same optimal value and essentially the same first stage decision. And we managed to solve this problem in less than 12 minutes. So instead of 1,000 minutes, now 12 minutes, obtaining more or less the same decision, statistically the same decisions and optimal value. If you reduce more in this case, and then although we have another S between optimum values, but the decisions by the Komogorov-Smirnov test are not the same, statistically the same. So let's take a close look at this result here. We are also interested in thermal production and hydro production for the first stage. And those values are obtained by the original tree and this one by the reduced tree. And the results are the same, in fact. And here is the curve of the empirical probability distribution. We see one curve, but in fact, there are two curves here. Because they are really aderent. See, the Komogorov, the test was really small, the value of the test really small. If you give a zoom here, you can see that there is a blue line, a bit different. Yeah. Well, so as a conclusions, the results indicate that the nested distance is a very powerful tool to reduce, to obtain a smaller tree, but very representative in terms of the stochastic process, to represent the stochastic process. Improvements in with the algorithm can be obtained if you define different distance matrices. Distance functions. And the next step now, Philippe is working his PhD, is to extend those results for a bigger system, considering more power plants, and inflows are presented by autoregressive model. In this case, you don't have time independence, so the tree will be much bigger. Here's some main references of this work. How many of these? Kovacevic Prichler, George Pflug here also. And well, that's all. Thank you very much for your attention.